Canadian rocker Jim Gutty is coming to the NAC, and we're giving away free tickets to see him April 5th. Email us to get in on the contest. You'll also get a copy of the new CD Constellation. Email us at ottawacontest@ctv.ca. Good luck in the draw to you, Michael.
What a great voice he has. Well, when you hear of CNIB, or what was formerly called the Canadian Institute for the Blind, you just assume it's been around forever. Well, Ian Cusack now on a milestone.
Michael, not forever, but the CNIB has been around for 100 years. And to mark the century, the executive director, Dwayne Morgan, and CNIB volunteer archivist, Jane Beaumont, are here to help us look back at a very interesting history. And Dwayne, I know you're also, as an executive director, excited to talk about the future. But I think so few would know how this organization, which has had such meaning in so many people's lives, how it really came to be. And Jane, this was a history that fascinates you.
It does. So when I was chair of the board and we started to talk about the centenary, I started to look back. And I discovered that actually the CNIB grew out of a library, and I'm a librarian, so that was even better. So in 1906, a blind gentleman and his wife founded a library and started to make Braille books and lend books. And by just before the First World War, there was a board for this library. The founder had actually died, but there was a board of who were overseeing the library. And they started to realize that the country needed more than a library. It needed rehabilitation and training services. And that was emphasized by the people starting to return from the First World War.
Some images, those returning from the First World War, yeah. And we also have images of the Halifax explosion. So both World War One and the Halifax explosion really, really, I guess, galvanized the understanding of need. Explain that, if you would.
That's exactly it. It wasn't the reason why CNIB was founded, but it raised public awareness. People began to realize what the world of blind people was like, which was very limited. And several people had wonderful training in London after they'd been blinded in the war. Long-time managing director Edwin Baker was one of those. So by the time the Halifax explosion happened in December 1917, CNIB was on its way. They were involved in the library, and they were starting to talk about a national organization.
Now, the Halifax explosion and the story of it is quite something, because and how the blindness occurred. It wasn't the, as I understand it, being a Haligonian, it wasn't the first explosion, but after the first explosion, so many people ran to the windows. I'll have you explain the rest.
Well, actually, it was more that people ran to the window to look at the Mont Blanc, which was on fire, and they didn't know, and it was a massive blaze, but they didn't know that boat was full of incredibly flammable weapon materials. And about 20 minutes after the original collision, it blew up, and that was what destroyed the north end of the city. And people all over the city who were at the windows got glass in their eyes and in their faces. Many, many of them died from other injuries.